Good morning, everyone. And
good morning.
Today is the third day of our online lecture series, titled Productive Engagement of University Teachers and Research Fellows During COVID-19 Lockdown. And our speaker for today is Professor Dr. Amarendra Narayan Mishra, our revered Honorable Vice Chancellor of Calicut University. And the topic that he has chosen for his talk is Capacity Building in University Level Teaching. And this is a very interesting topic, Capacity Building in University Level Teaching, because I don't want to speak at this moment. Maybe after the lecture is over, I will pitch in. Now, with this background, I would like to again thank all our Vice Chancellor who have been, participating in this webinar, online lecture series. And I would like to extend my heartfelt thanks to Professor Mishra for giving his consent to deliver today's lecture. And Professor Mishra, now it's your time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Welcome to all the audiences for this webinar. It's a wonderful series organized by Professor Behera. I'm thankful to him that he has invited me to deliver a talk on this topic. It is his topic assigned to me as a homework during this pandemic, and I love to prepare this because this is essential. We have been doing it without getting background knowledge, but with our experience, this capacity building in university level teaching has been done. When I prepared the talk, I realized because we have a heterogeneous community hearing this speech, maybe I can define capacity, then building, and the university level teaching in a different perspective. When we talk of capacity, we talk in different spheres, different time scale, and different physical and philosophical capacities. So if it is a physical capacity, it is the space occupied by any physical matter. But when it comes to any ethical thing, it is a relative term. What can be the capacity, whether it is higher, lower, middle, like that. When it comes to building, it is, I have made a small blocks. It is a building block. You can go on adding blocks to your building. Anything and everything we are doing, we go on adding one after the other gradually, and then build a structure we have in our mind, or the society needs, or what is better for everybody. So capacity building is just to enhance or create a facility which will be for everybody's good. In the university level teaching, when we are coming to university level teaching, it is to be defined what is university level teaching. University level teaching is a tertiary education leading towards an academic degree. It is a post-secondary education and is called a third level or tertiary education after the primary and secondary school, and is optional. It's not compulsory, because we always think that primary education is enough for knowledge acquisition, preparing the person to be able to read and write and communicate. Secondary school prepares the diversity of jobs and scopes that is available in the society, So a person graduating from secondary school can enter into the society with his or her skills. But what is the tertiary education or the university education gives is an optional final stage of formal learning. So it is not compulsory that everybody should come to the university education, but it is a final stage of formal learning. Then here you enhance your skills in different aspects, which gives you immense scope to serve the society. So university education, when we think of capacity building, should empower and enable the person to serve the society in a better way. And here I am showing one of the things why education is so important. When we think of transformation for the world in 2030, this agenda is given, there are 17 parameters, and the foremost parameter is quality education. When we talk of quality, quality is also a relative term, and quality can be transformed into quantity, but that depends on the person or the metrics which you are following and the parameters you are following. So we have to have a benchmark by which we have to define the base with which we'll develop our quality or the capacity. Capacity has different dimensions, I have told you. It is has to be defined what capacity you are going to build, how you are going to build, and for whom you are going to build. Because it cannot be same for all sorts of skills, and it cannot be for all times to come. It is always, capacity is always contemporary, and you have to look into the need of the place, need of the society, and the resource availability. So what you have to do is to effectively respond to this time and space, and then create and develop a sustainable local capacity. Otherwise, when we build that capacity or develop that capacity, it may not be sustainable. This is a cartoon, I love it. The application of knowledge and expertise to the enhancement of those factors that contribute to organizational effectiveness is capacity building. You can see the leader who is building the capacity is there as the leader, and his supporting elements, these are personalized, but these are elements of the capacity building that lifts the capacity to a higher level. Then let's come to some conceptual part of capacity building. It is that which treats the skills and competencies needed as linked to the immediate task. I have told you it is a time-specific task. Capacity building and capacity development are often used interchangeably. Capacity building is the process by which individuals, which is the pivotal point, I'm repeating, all the individuals in any system or organization are the pivotal for the organization, and the capacity building depends on the individual development or the organizations in a collective manner to obtain, improve, and retain the skills, knowledge, tools, and equipments and other resources. This is very important, needed to do their job competently. And these resources, we talk of local available resources. not resources to be drawn from somewhere else. It allows individuals and organizations to perform at a greater capacity, that means in a larger scale, larger audience, and larger impact to come. This is a UN definition which I have borrowed it. And at what happens at individual level is to build and enhance knowledge and skills by adapting to change. Any individual who cannot adapt to a change, suppose I am from Delhi, I come to Orissa and to a rural place, a urbanite working in a rural area has to adapt to that circumstance and that particular time to enhance his knowledge and skills to work there and build the capacity to enhance the societal needs and the institutional needs. And the institutional level, it needs capacity building, needs aiding the institutions, not by creating new institutions, rather modernizing the existing institutions and supporting them. I hope this goes to everybody, because this is the essence of capacity building. Societal level, the capacity building is through the feedback it receives from the population at large, we call the stakeholders. So the feedback taken from the stakeholders should be our vital point for building the capacity and rejuvenating it and taking it further. At the non-training level, it provides an environment for the trained staff to perform at their optimum level. We always talk of maximum level, but at the optimum level, in a normal curve, optimum level is at the median or the mid-level. Then I have already told the definition of the capacity development, which is given by United Nations. The capacity development is the process through which individuals, organizations, and societies obtain, strengthen, and maintain the capacities to set and achieve their own development objective over time. Own. This own is more important than anything else. What capacity we have to build at Sambalpur University is not same as that we have to develop at Calicut University. And what we are developing at Calicut University need not be the same, because it is a new university. It should not be superimposed or copied for the development of our newly developing universities at Balangir or Kalahandi, because these are community specific and local resource specific. So capacity is the ability of individuals, institutions, and society to perform functions, solve problems, and set and achieve objectives in a sustainable manner. Sustainable manner, there is a time scale. So how long we have to sustain? An institute sustains for centuries. So taking into this time scale, we have to plan a sustainable development plan for our universities. Capacity development is the how of making development work better, and it's about making institutions better able to deliver and promote human development. In summary, it is a dynamic process, contemporary and consumer driven. Today, all the university curriculum, whether you agree or don't agree, it is mostly consumer driven. What is, who are the consumers in this modern consumer age? Are the human resource we are developing, they are our consumers. That means our students and the society itself is our consumer. So we have to plan community development, what they need. They should give feedback what they need, and we have to develop our education, our curriculum, our design and the infrastructure as per the consumer needs. and it should be contemporary, a dynamic process. Dynamic means we have to change from time to time. We cannot remain obsolete 50 years back and think that our system is foolproof. Nothing is foolproof. Everything has to change as per the change of time, change of the technology, and we have understood how this development is dynamic at this pandemic period. Within 2 months, we have realized from classroom teaching, we have to go for hybrid teaching methods. So this has to be contemporary, dynamic, and consumer-driven. Then, before I go for the process by which it has to develop, it has to be built, let me give this. What is capacity development? I have given, as a biologist or a plant biologist, I have given this example, a big tree which is standing straight. We see its above ground structure, but we don't see its below ground structure which sustains that tree. So the development is like a tree. It can be nurtured in its growth only by feeding its root, not by pulling its branches. This is the philosophy of development for anything you say, and this also holds true for capacity development. So we have to understand what is our basic root with which our university education has to develop, and what is the necessity of the society, what type of education our society, our people want, that we have to develop. Then, what are the elements of, so before going to develop, it is like the branching roots, and what are the roots or the elements of capacity development? Each element has to develop in order to develop the capacity. And these elements are first learning materials, approaches, developing community resource persons and centers, partnering capacities. This is community resource persons, I am again repeating, because we don't involve community in our teaching methods or education so far. We have to learn from the community, and they should be a partner of progress or development for our capacity building in universities. And centers, partnering capacity, just like industry, we call industry partnership, but we don't involve them to develop our curriculum, syllabus, what they exactly need, what type of manpower they need, that has to come from them. So it is a bi-directional process. It is a collective responsibility that we involve them, and they should also be a partner of progress for our universities. And then develop future research leaders who can give direction to these young budding minds of the university who are coming to polish their knowledge and skills, not for acquiring simply knowledge, but polish knowledge and skills and become societal leaders. Then it's gender sensitized. When I look at the society, since my childhood till today, I think Indian society is more gender neutral than any other society in the world. In this society, in Indian society, contemporary society and old society, our girl folk or the woman folk have immense contribution to societal building or capacity development than we theoretically think or calculate. Domestic productivity, institutional productivity, and social productivity without women folk is zero. Then, institutional strengthening. When we talk of institution, it doesn't encompass only few individuals, neither only teachers, nor only the non-teaching staff, but it also encompasses or take into consideration the stakeholders and society, the nearby villages, the nearby community, and the nation as a whole. So institutional strengthening should take into consideration the national need, state or regional need, and the local needs. Then only you can think of an institutional strengthening model rather than just copying a rural model into an urban or to a semi-urban or like that. It will be a collapsing model. It cannot have a sustainability. Then simply strengthening cannot matter. Like we have a concrete construction, then we water it, cure it, monitor it, and evaluate the strength. Similarly, this strength day by day and individual to individual has to be monitored and evaluated, not just by periodically, but every moment. So it doesn't have a time scale. It is a continuous evaluation. What we are now thinking of continuous evaluation, continuous monitoring will develop our capacities in the universities. Then organizational development, this is a holistic responsibility of the insider, the human resource we are developing, or the students, the teachers, and other staff. And when it comes to organizational development, the best thing what I have seen, the society builds an organization and the society destroys the organization. The society is the real stakeholder and the real developer of any organization. And it comes to research. Research should be contemporary and societal. It cannot be just whimsical, driven by some journals, some groups, and some fancy. Research, in my perception, if I draw 10 lakh rupees of projects, can I give theoretically or practically 10 times return to the society in terms of knowledge, in terms of technology, in terms of ability? Because research means we generate or create new abilities for betterment of science and society, so that technology will develop to serve the masses, not to a group of people or a group of or a limited area. Every time when we talk of elements of capacity development, the final comes to need for assessment and intervention strategy. We call disruptive strategies, computers, IT, all these things. When we develop through this cycle of elemental development and research, organization development, when it grew, it developed to maximum capacity if we think of contemporary things today. But when it grew, now we are assessing and feeling that it intervening in every sphere of life. So why it intervene? what are the strategy and how we can change our strategy to develop in a better way so that the whole society can be benefited. So we have to come out with another cycle of research, another cycle of learning and knowledge, another cycle of human resource development, so that we get an alternative developmental plan. This is what I have already defined, and this is measuring the capacity at personal level, which is product and service. Then outcome is at the institutional level, performance, adaptability and stability, I have already told you. And then it culminates in the national development goals. So whatever contemporary developmental goals the nation fixes or plans, our capacity building should match to it, not that it will be different and what we need and what we want. It should be matching to the national developmental goals. So we have to adapt and perform and stabilize our capacity so that we really match to the developmental goals of the nation. So we have to develop each individual with leadership, knowledge, and accountability. This accountability is most important because it is individual accountability, institutional accountability, and community accountability. That has to be taken care. If there is no accountability, the strong capacity building method will collapse because nobody is accountable and everybody's responsibility is nobody's responsibility. So this is what I have been telling: individual level, organizational level, and institutional level, how we can develop the capacity and how we can measure it properly. At the individual level, there should be technical competency, management competency, governance competency, and learning competency. You update your knowledge to and skills for technical competency, then for management competency, project management skills, and leadership, which a leader of any, suppose head of the department, a dean, all these things, a group leader, a lab manager, they have to have managerial skills and leadership quality. This can be inculcated and cultivated. There's nothing called, there can be some inborn leadership, but until and unless you culture it, you develop it, it is of no use. So managerial competence is a rigorous culturing of self managerial skills, developing knowledge, and then governance, ability to engage with and listen to stakeholders, and inclusiveness should be there. What we are now following in our modern education, this has been there since I have seen my, since my childhood. I know inclusiveness there in India and in many other democratic countries. And then learning competencies, readiness to critically reflect and own performance. So critically you analyze yourself. Nobody will criticize you when we are averse to criticism. That's one of the worst part of each individual we see and we come across. If I criticize productively also, people feel offended. But if you critically analyze yourself, you will improve on your performance, and that will build your own capacity. When it comes to organizational level, then engineering, legal, and financial technical competence, then leaders be able to operate with goals agreed with supervisors, because we have also supervisors and stakeholders who should also be vigilant and also come out with criticism and innovative, constructive, thought-provoking ideas. Then governance should be transparent. At any time when governance has not been transparent, the system is under suspicion and decision making becomes concentrated, and this becomes anarchic. And consultations and accountability, I have already told, then learning competence can in the organization level can be by formulating procedures, incentives, etc., just like our regulations, act and statutes, like that. At the institutional level, similar things, but at a better manner. And the main key factor is workable tax assignment of sector agencies, and minimal overlap should be there at the institutional level. Regulations to ensure transparency and accountability, openness to review sector performance and revise policies. At the institutional level, like universities, we have to have a frequent and rigorous revision policies. That is vital for capacity building and contemporary societal relevance. This is who are responsible for such things is faculty, research faculty and researchers, which are the three key factors for university education and university academic development or capacity building. If your faculty capacity in terms of their ability and capability, then ability and skill, the faculty is good and they deliver goods with individual competency and with collective capabilities, then you can have a better societal or organizational development and achieve or attain the goals on a sustainable basis. If your faculty or research faculty or researchers do not have a collective capabilities, even if they have wonderful individual ability, the university or the institution or the organizational development capacity building will not be fruitful. So what I emphasize here is the collective capability of our faculty, our researchers and research faculty. That means we have to have collaborations, cooperations and openness, open discussions, criticisms, and come out with policies which will develop and enhance your knowledge and skills so that you can deliver better goods to your students and to your society. So this is the same thing, but I divide it into two type of thing. We always think of quality and quantity. Quality we call excellence. It is outcome driven. Suppose yesterday and day before yesterday we had two learned professors who delivered about the quality education, research, publications, etc. This is outcome driven. Suppose I teach in a class, out of 20, 15 of my students secure good marks in a semester, then I have to think why the other 5 students didn't do well. What went wrong? It is not, you should be complacent with the 15 students doing well. So this is a self-assessment and it is outcome driven. Then you have to plan in a manner that the last boy or the girl in the last bench should come out and compete with the first, or have developed a capacity and capability to compete, or have the knack to compete with the first boy or the first girl in the first bench. Once you have this inherent competition, then to develop a qualitative teaching, qualitative research, and qualitative classroom or educational system which you can deliver. And then quantity, maximize the capacity. Suppose I am a student, a teacher, then I have to see maximum number of my students should excel or do better and better and better. And every moment, every time you strive to for betterment, you have a goal for excellence. Excellence is a continuous betterment policy and planning that you can reach nearer to excellence, but excellence is never achievable. This is the layered model for the capacity development. It can be developed at the individual level, organizational level, but to develop all these two, you have an enabling environment that the institutional framework and the power structure, or we call the establishment or the office, should provide. And this will influence these two, individual level or organizational level development, and will have a deepening, effective, accountable state citizen engagement. This is what I have told you, and I have been emphasizing every time, everywhere, that state citizen engagement is vital for academic development. When we call or talk of our alumni, once the students pass out, they become the state citizen. They engage to our institution or the university, and that deeply, once they involve in the process of our organizational development and individual level development, then our universities will excel or develop to a achievable limit. This is a linear scale. I have shown this is a circular model or three-dimensional model of capacity development, where individual area is at the center or the hub point of all capacity development is the individual. But individual should not only have a knowledge and competency, but what is vital for each individual for capacity development of an organization and the universities is the attitude and the behavior and the ethical values. We should have attitude for cooperation, collaboration, and behavior should be amicable, and values or the moral values should be that it will encourage every individual to inculcate those values as a model, and that is how this capacity building can be done when you are a teacher. Then organizational development are the dimensions, as said, mandate, system, internal processing, organizational priorities, motivation, and financial and non-financial incentives. This motivation and financial and non-financial incentives, all the motivation we can do individually or department-wise, financial and non-financial incentives sometimes become limited because of our resource crunch. But nevertheless, non-financial incentives are there. Motivation is there, which gives us the strength for organizational development. Collaborations and infrastructure and equipments, this infrastructure and equipment, I always say in state universities particularly, we have to mobilize extramural research, and this research should be cross-disciplinary and cross-institutional, so that every institute, every discipline can grow. It is not a compartmentalized subject or discipline, or compartmentalized into science, technology, humanities, commerce, management, like that. Everybody should cooperate and collaborate to bring huge amount of, not simply projects in number, but huge amount of money, manpower, and develop the infrastructure of the universities, so that your university will be proud to be one of the successful universities that has developed the capacity to do research and teaching. And then at the periphery, what influences, like environment influences every society and individual, it is the enabling environment that the institutional setup of a country like India, implicit and explicit rules like acts, statute, regulations, and power structure should be very clear. It should be defined. There should not be any ambiguity. Particularly, multi-stakeholder process. I have told you, you have to have involvement of the stakeholders and legal policy and policies. This is again, when we talk of this structure, here is a four-layer structure which gives to program an intermediate structure. And community development is a continuous process which starts with technical, operational, systemic, adaptive, and influencing methods. It should be influencing to the society and to the stakeholder, and develop leadership. So we need lot of intermediate steps, not simply one step, two step. It is a multi-step and interdependent steps, which these steps have made blocks. They are not separate blocks. They are building blocks which are interdependent. One factor strengthens the other factors, and each factor, when you make a network of all these factors, that makes the community or the capacity development or capacity building a continuous process. And this continuous process, when you come to networking, advocacy, and thought leadership, and then you go on monitoring, reassessing, assessing, and then redesigning. So this framework of continuous development should be there, and one has to be engrossed, totally engrossed into the system. Suppose I am a teacher, I should be engrossed into my teaching methodology and the grasping capacity of my students, how to lift them from a very poor standard to a high standard, so that tomorrow I will be proud as a teacher, I will be proud as a professor, as the head of the department, how much development plan I could do for my department, and how much money my faculties can mobilize, how many faculties went beyond my departmental limits, beyond my university limits, beyond my country limits, to cooperate and collaborate with researchers and teachers outside, and brought back cross-disciplinary knowledge, which is the foundation of our capacity building and skill to deliver at the local level. This is one of the most important messages what I want to deliver here, that we have to bring skill, knowledge, and deliver it locally. This is what I've already told you. This is the summary of skill, coaching, knowledge, teaching, learning, supporting, and development, which is called capacity building. Then what are the processes? I've told you how it goes on, what are the components, and how we'll develop the capacity. We have to, at the first stage, when we have to develop a capacity or an institute or a university, we have to engage partners and build consensus. What is to be done, how it has to be done, and for whom it has to be done. Three things in a consensus manner we have to build the capacity, and then assess the capacity assets and the needs of the society, a contemporary society, and then formulate the strategies for implementation at step four. And then once I implement or we implement the strategies, we have to monitor simply that we had a consensus and the number was bigger, we had a need and we formulated according to that need and implemented. That doesn't mean anything until and unless you monitor, evaluate how much the outcome is there, because every capacity building or development is outcome based. How much my students, my faculty, my staff, and my society or our society benefited, accordingly the evaluation should be done, so that this cycle, at least in a particular time frame, we can say the consensus of building this capacity was fruitful, not excellent. It is just fruitful. This is same, but sometimes when we say it is fruitful, it may not be by the time we are assessing, there is a time lapse. So that time lapse, because it is 3 years, 5 years time gap, it may not be contemporary again. What I have thought 5 years back is not same today. And what I thought in December was not same in February because of the pandemic. So I have to revise. You can see this here. You have to revise and reformulate approaches and target groups. After evaluation and assessment, we have to revise the reformulate approach target groups and then again set the priorities. So these two have come depending on the necessity of time and location and changing of the dynamics of the population. You have to revise and reformulate the target groups and approaches and priorities, your settings, which should be a dynamic planning. Taking into the present change, we can formulate at least 5 or 10 years plan, and that should be achievable. That should be achievable. These are the steps: planning, decision making, implementation, and system development. And at this system, at the top level, we have to analyze efforts to create sustained system of improvement using existing resources. I told you, every time we are thinking, I can make Harvard here, I can make Stanford here, but what is our existing resources that we don't take into consideration? What we need, what our society needs. So this is taking into existing resources, we have to plan and improve the system or build the capacity. When it comes to a capacity building, suppose we have a university. Now we developed a university, new university. I realized once it is established, the first cycle is over in 1 year. Then we had to reassess, redesign, second cycle. Again, in the third year, it may change. So when we are building one after the other capacity, we are developing different resources, then the question of rights and responsibilities comes. There, stakeholders have their rights. There, the individuals in the organization or the university have the rights. And when it comes to responsibility, every individual says it's the responsibility of the institution. This model gives similar things, but when we have rights, we have responsibility. Every individual has to develop their capacity to look into their rights and build or develop their responsibilities or maximize their responsibilities so that the institution can develop in a sustainable manner. But the institution also has responsibilities for its elements, and it should be accountable. There should be a process of accountability to empower their faculties, students, and staff. This type of model will develop in a sustainable capacity development of a university where people will be happy. This is happiness index, which is coming these days. When I was a student, I know I was always happy learning, interacting with teachers. I don't know why in the university we have a lower happiness index in India. We have probably in the world, our students, our faculties have more rights enjoyed, more responsibilities, and we enjoy as student and as faculty and as administrators more happiness than anywhere on earth. So when it comes to delivering any goods or capacity, achievable capacity, when I'm happy, when I'm free, when I'm given a free hand, then I can deliver better, better and better. Because my involvement to the institution, my involvement to the department becomes better, and I become a responsible citizen of the society, understanding their demands. And I'm always committed to meet the societal demand and the state demand. So training, learning, knowledge, skills, coaching, support, and development is the basis and foundation of our capacity building in the university or the society. And these are the pivots or the pillars which are sustaining this is governance, funding, planning that gives you sustainability. Then everything is not fair when we don't go for a cost-benefit ratio. In most of our state universities, it is state-funded, and we think that we are doing it because the state is funding, but we have to go for a cost-benefit analysis for capacity building in the university also. Then I did this SWOT analysis given, because we always think that we have developed. What are the strength of capacity building in a university? Is the environmental demand, fiscal crisis, change champions, cross-departmental communication, internal efficiency demands, redundant technology and education, but opposing forces are centralized power, weak integration, fear of jobless, non-rational cultures, vested interests. Most of the teachers, you can understand what is vested interest and limited awareness of the policies, societal demand. These are our weaknesses for which the universities are becoming weaker and weaker. Then here I have summarized. It is not single circle, it is a multiple circle. Every time and space you have to design and redesign and go on assessing and developing knowledge gradually. So it is a spiraling thing. In a circular manner, I have shown it, but when it becomes longer time, just like Utkal, Sambalpur or Barampur, it has spiraled. Now we are in only one single circle. Few universities can be having 3-4 cycles. So like this, we have to develop, and then it becomes like a spring which can absorb the pressure and bounce back. These old universities have developed a spring-like structure, these circles, several cycles, and sitting over that, where whenever there is a pressure, it bounces back like a spring and come out with a successful developmental plan. I conclude, it has been said that a passion for excellence carries a price. This is what capacity development means. And it is a cooperative manner by which we have to develop. And this is what is the model. If you are successful, you handhold and help the other to reach to the zenith. And that is how, in a cooperative and collective manner, we can develop our capacities and try for excellence. Thank you very much for your patience hearing.
Professor Misra, for your wonderful speech, and it was quite informative and rightly said by you. It's a ongoing, you know, dynamic process which is related to time and space. So the kind of development capacity building you think of in a university, boarding university like Calicut, cannot be conceived in case of Sambalpur University. And there are lot many questions, but you know, at the beginning I didn't want to introduce you, thinking that before the discussion starts, the question answer session starts, I would introduce yourself, and participant, you would be happy to know a little bit about Professor Amarendra Misra. The Vice Chancellor of Calicut University, is a renowned plant biologist. Professor Misra was a undergraduate at Barampur University. From there, he also postgraduated and earned his doctoral degree in 1983. He had a stint as a researcher at Sambalpur University for his study of photosynthesis. Professor Misra was a postdoctoral fellow at JNU Imperial College, London. Professor Misra begins his teaching career in Rajasthan Agricultural University in 1982, and subsequently taught at various universities, namely Utkal University, University of Pune, Fakir Mohan University, Central University of Jharkhand. Professor Misra has to his credit 130 publications in reputed journals. He guided 8 PhD students and successfully completed 18 research projects. He has established a collaboration with several leading institutions located in 15 different countries: Imperial College, University of Wales, University of Geneva, University of Tokyo, University of Nevada, US, have been his academic destination. For his distinguished academic pursuit, Professor Misra was awarded prestigious fellowship from European Community, Japan Society for the Foundation of Science, and Fulbright Scholar Fellowship. Professor Misra also has the distinction of being the fellow of scientific bodies such as Indian Botanical Society, Indian Society for Agricultural Biochemist, Academic of Environmental Biology, Environmental Society for Tropical Crops Research and Development. appointed the Vice Chancellor of Calicut University since July 2017. Professor Mishra has shoulder of various responsibility of grooming this pleasing institution to a full stature. This is the brief introduction, and Professor Mishra, we are really delighted to have you as one of our speaker, and we'll be happy to know that this is also, you know, in Facebook Live, many participants are watching. Now, there are some questions. Before that, I request our moderator to pitch in and summarize within 5 minutes what has been said.
Please. So, as I was saying, capacity building is the buzzword of contemporary system of knowledge economy. And Professor A.R. Mishra emphasizes that capacity building process is a continuous process, and it is circular with a spiraling mode. He talks about how capacity building envisages development of the society, taking into account needs of the society, which are absolutely local, and he also emphasizes using the local resources. He talks about how important it is to obtain, improve, and retain the skills of knowledge and development of the equipment and which are necessary for doing jobs competently. He emphasized feedback from stakeholders, including the alumni, which is necessary for the institution to be responsive, responsible, as well as credible, and capacity to solve problems and enhance human development and meet consumer needs are also points which received his emphasis. He stressed research which ought to be need-based, and it should involve need assessment of the institution and work out strategies that are feasible within the university. And he said that these research actually is localized. And then he talked about different kinds of competence, technical competence, management competence, governance competence, and learning competence, etc. Then he talked about the collective capacity of the faculty, and all faculty should work as a team. So this integrative and synchronic working of faculties is very necessary. And then he talked about human resource development, which involves enhancing quality and quantity. Then he talked about this layout model of capacity development, and he said it is this capacity development is a continuous process of skill, knowledge, involving the local needs, and also it aims at capturing the local needs of the people and addressing the local targets as well as beneficiaries. And plans should be worked out in specific time frames to deliver the goods. Thank you very much, sir. And this, you will be very happy to know that your talk has generated very thoughtful response by way of observation from no one other than Professor Ashok Das, Vice Chairman of Higher Education, who, as you know, in his speech emphasized the value system in education. So his question, in fact, his observation is, what are the ways and means of incorporating in capacity building process value system? And he has asked you to respond. This is an observation number one. And the two, the second observation, which is very important, is that actually we have de-emphasized fundamental research, which is, everybody knows, is a critical factor in knowledge production. So what is your view? I mean, fundamental research, as he says, unveils mysteries of nature and universe, which are very important, along with the societal significant research. Please do comment. And then, of course, I would move on to one more question by Professor Das and take a few more questions. So.
Okay, when we talk of, first I'll thank Professor Das for his questions. It is very difficult question, but I think the value, ethical values in higher education. We have been talking of value education at every level. When we have ethical values at the school level, why there always I question it in this manner, why it is eroding in our college education? Because college education is the bridging educational system between your university education and the school education. So it is during this plus two level, probably we are missing this element in our educational system for which the value education or inculcation of values, human values in a adolescent individual or growing individual who is going to be responsible for the society tomorrow is not being nurtured at that level. Second, I think you have to repeat the second question. Hello?
Yes. The second question is that actually fundamental research has been de-emphasized. So what are the ways and means of emphasizing fundamental research and incorporating it in the process of capacity building? How can it be done?
Okay, fundamental research, how it is in the national building. When we talk of fundamental research, always we think of those research which cannot be applied. But when you look into any type of research, whether sociological, commercial, scientific, basic science, which we call fundamental research, we have to have a approach and we have to analyze what are the fundamental problems of our society, nearby society, if we work deeply in that to develop or solve the problems of local community or the local region, taking into a holistic approach, not a fractional approach. Holistic approach means socio, scientific, and economic, all inclusive. Then only you can develop or suggest a plan, a method, and a solution for any problem. And I think that is what research needs. Research doesn't need that I have hundreds of publications, I am a great scientist, no. Research needs how much of your knowledge developed by your fundamental research is being followed, implemented, and then it has gone to application level. I hope I am clear.
Can I interject, sir?
Yes, sir, please.
Sir, I'll come to the central issue that I want to raise.
Yes.
We somehow have, I had a feeling that the capacity building has become basically corporatization of education, corporatization of academy. The issue that I found must should be taken up by all of us, because yes, you are a thought leader. The issue that should be taken is how to develop the passion in teaching, the passion in research beyond the head. We need to also bring some heart into the teachers. Now, corporatization is fine. In America, great universities have presidents and a corporate structure. But that is limited because it is outcome income based. It evaluates everything in a consumerist style. In India, we have still somehow maintained a hybrid structure of passion and consumerism. And maybe we are being driven towards consumerism. Now, how do you develop capacity to in the teachers to preserve the passion? That was essentially, since I asked the question as you went along, it became piecemeal. But that was the issue. I won't disturb you any longer. Thank you very much. It was a brilliant lecture.
I'll just give some idea, because this is still a long-term question. It is contemporary also. When you give a free hand to a teacher with rigorous assessment, periodically observe it, then just promote them morally, then I think we can develop good teachers. It is not that you can develop 100% good, because 100% is a not achievable number. But if I cross 80% limit, I think I have achieved the goal. I hope I am clear.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Indeed, Professor Das, actually, as you know, his philosophy is that education should be humane, value-based, and very impassioned. Passion does play a very important critical role in teaching and research, and that's precisely, that was his point, and the point is very well taken, sir. Now we move on to a few questions, and this Aparajita Chaudhary, who actually has a very specific question. It is, what role can the superannuated people play in capacity building at the level of university education?
Can you just say once more?
Yeah. The superannuated people, what role do they have to play? Do they have to play at capacity
Which
building?
People? Which people?
People who have retired from service.
Okay, okay, okay. That's a great thing. That's a great thing. People who have retired, it is not, I always have aversion to the word called retirement. We call it superannuation. Teachers never retire. I always say I'll die as a teacher, because every day when I superannuate from my job, I'll be reading new things. I'll have free time, and I'll leisurely read things which is my passion. It's not necessarily I am from plant biology, I'll read only plant biology. I have passion for literature, I'll read literature, I can develop that, and all these things. And with experience, when we say a retired professor in the so-called traditional manner, a person who has taught 30 to 40 years, their experience, expertise, and above all, it's not simply experience and expertise, but the wisdom they have developed in the academic circle, that has to be utilized. I hope the word called wisdom of our elderly teachers must be taken and profitably utilized by all the universities for value addition for their noble and novice teachers who are entering into the system. And these people are role models and can be utilized as mentors who can handhold our young faculties, direct them in the right direction, and mobilize them to be innovative, sincere, hardworking, and committed teachers.
Thank you, sir, for taking this question and adding to a very vital point that retired teachers who have experience and expertise can play a very vital role in capacity building. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Mishra, for your interesting and informative speech. We all enjoyed listening to you. And on behalf of Sambalpur University, I would like to extend my heartfelt thanks. But at the same time, I would like to inform all our participants. Tomorrow also there is a lecture, and that lecture will be delivered by Professor Somendra Mohan Patnaik, Vice Chancellor, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Utkal University, and he will be speaking on ethics in research and teaching. So please don't forget to join us. The time is 11 o'clock. Tomorrow, 11 o'clock, we all would expect you to join us. And this lecture delivered by Professor Misra is also on live Facebook. So many people are watching you, Professor Misra. You will be happy to know that. And I would like to thank all my technical staff who have been working days out, and I mean all the day round, and they are putting in a lot of labor to make this event a grand success. And I would like to extend my heartfelt thanks to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, former Vice Chancellor Professor Das, to raise question. Professor Isan Patra was also there, and 3-4 more Vice Chancellor were there. So we are all feeling excited to see this kind of response for a small initiative taken by Sambalpur University. Thank you very much.
At the end, I thank Professor Behra and all our Vice Chancellors of Odisha who are proactively participating in this initiative. It is a wonderful initiative. I personally thank Professor Behra for inviting me for such a talk, which was really, I appreciate. This was really a homework for me after my passing out MSc. Probably this was first homework given by any person to me, and I enjoyed taking it myself, and I reread many things, and then from my experience, these slides, I tried to recapitulate.
Would you like to speak a few words?
Yes, concluding. Hello?
Hello?
Yes?
Yes? I'm talking this to Professor Isan Patra.
Okay, please. I'm
on the screen, so your comments on the lecture and any kind of input that you would like to make.
Okay, please.
Yeah. Well, it was a wonderful discourse, and it's an eye-opener for all the education leaders, and particularly the young faculty who are now entering into the higher education system. Capacity building is not only the responsibility of the leader, it's the responsibility of the whole team. And every young man should try to develop an acumen to be speaking like Professor Misra on such great topics in future. See, each one of you are vice chancellors in making. So we expect all of you to really do a lot of homework like our friend has done, and keep writing and write good articles in some of the Odia newspapers or even in national newspapers on capacity building with particular emphasis or with specific emphasis on education system in Odisha. And I always very proudly say that Odisha education system and the degrees from Odia universities are respected all over the world, and all Indian universities, they have got a high feeling for our students when they go for admissions in other places. So our scholars and our younger teachers should now start thinking about it. They themselves have to come up with this idea of capacity building and improving their own institute, taking their own institute to a great level. If they grow, the institute grows. If the institute grows, they grow further. So that's the concluding statement. I'm so happy this lecture series is going very, very great. See you tomorrow and day after also.
Thanks, Dr. Patra, for your comments, quick comments. And once again, I extend my heartfelt thanks to Professor Misra. And thanks, everyone, for joining us. And tomorrow, please don't forget to join us.